Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. May God Almighty's divine peace and blessings, strength and power, His light and His guidance be with you, with myself, with all of us, inshallah ta'ala, with all of our community. This is Ihsan, welcome. I've been traveling quite a bit over the last few weeks, so I haven't had a chance to upload as much as I intend. There's so much sometimes that it's so difficult to do. But I wanted to get a few videos out again before I actually head out again tomorrow on another journey. So there's a couple of things I wanted to quickly just touch on in this video. And the first one is relating to vaccines. After my last couple of videos where I've mentioned, you know, my experience with COVID, I've gotten a lot of inquiries about, did I take the vaccine? What is my opinion on the vaccine for COVID-19? And even people asking me if I recommend that they take it or not. So I want to first and foremost say that, just to quickly sort of touch this topic because I got so many inquiries about it, I'm not a medical professional. What I do is look at data, look at information, look at opinions, and at the end of the day, use my heart to decide what's the best route and course of action for me. And we can only take responsibility for ourselves. So I cannot recommend to anyone to take or not take the vaccine, but I can tell you my thought process regarding the vaccine for COVID-19, as well as what I feel, you know, what I believe in terms of my personal opinion. So I was on the fence for quite a while about whether or not I should take the vaccine or not. And I just, you know, wasn't sure what to do, which way to go. So I was waiting for guidance. And I remember one time I was actually at the gym on one of the treadmills, and you can't escape sometimes the televisions that are just in front of you. It's usually the only time that I get exposed to popular media and sort of the news and all of that, as much as I try to avoid it. And it just hit me one day. It was just almost overwhelming and upsetting and angering, the degree to which constant fear and manipulation and shaming was being used to sort of coerce people towards a certain course of action. And something just didn't feel right to me at that point. I don't like to be forced. I don't like to be coerced. I don't like to be manipulated, and I actually refuse to do so. I refuse as much as I can to not be pushed into doing anything. It has to be right. And I just became aware of how selective the recording was, and it was like so overwhelming, in the sense that the way this whole conversation was being had, and also becoming increasingly aware of the degree of censorship around this issue, my heart was like, okay, no. Right? I'm stepping back. I'm not going to do this out of fear or out of manipulation or out of shame, especially based on media. And so I started to actually start to look into and read a little bit more, watch a little bit more, try to educate myself a little bit more about this issue, which I kind of stayed away from, just, you know, sort of tried to step away from it for quite a while. So long story short, I never actually got the vaccine. I did get COVID-19. And I had at some point consciously recognized that I would have to just simply face this eventually when it came up, and rely on my immune system. You know, I wasn't particularly in one of the high risk categories. So under normal circumstances, I was fairly confident that, you know, I would get through it. Of course, at the end of the day, trusting and relying on Allah Almighty and His will. In terms of my opinion regarding this, I would defer to the specialists. And I don't mean just the specialists that are permitted to have opinions in the modern censorship culture, but of real people that have scientific, doctor, medical backgrounds, people that are intelligent, and people whose opinions seem to make sense. And there was a really good interview that was done by Jimmy Dore on his channel with Dr. Robert Malone, who is, I believe, the inventor of mRNA technology, vaccine technology. And Dr. Malone was of the opinion that the vaccine is useful for specific populations, specifically those who are immune compromised and the elderly, and that for people that are healthy and robust, especially the young, especially children, right, especially the age groups and categories of people who don't have comorbidities and who don't have other factors that could make their ability to deal with this virus more difficult, that, you know, for those people, it's not so critical. And in fact, he warned against over vaccinating the population, that could eventually actually potentially lead to increased resistance to the treatments and vaccine. It can lead to potentially to more mutations of the virus. So what he recommended was that the vaccine be used for people who are at high risk. And when you look into the data of people who actually have had very severe cases who have died from COVID-19. Most of the time, there were other factors involved, comorbidities and compromised immune systems and things like that. So again, that's the opinion of a medical scientific professional. There's a lot of other people that are kind of feel the same way. Some countries have begun now just like learning to accept that we're not going, and this is a fact at this point, we're not going to be able to vaccinate our way out of this problem. Vaccine does not prevent transmission. If anything, it can reduce the severity of symptoms, and that's in the short term. Long term, they're finding that, again, people are ending up with difficult cases of COVID in populations that are highly vaccinated. So I really don't want to spend any more time on this, but because this question came up, I recommend just people to do their own research and then check in with your heart. You have to decide what's best for you, and you have to decide what Allah's will is for you. And either one can be correct, right? But for me personally, I just decided that it made more sense to face this and rely on my immune system. And the truth of the fact is, the matter is that natural immunity is far superior to anything that the vaccine can provide. And for whatever reason, they refuse to admit this, talk about it, but the data is clear. So my recommendation, do your research. If anybody's interested, I'll just keep a link to that interview with Dr. Robert Malone in the description below this video if anybody wants to check it out and follow up and just, you know, do your own work and research, inshallah. And may Allah guide you to what's right and best for you and your family. Now, the other thing that I really wanted to talk about, that I've gotten that out of the way, and I apologize if that was a bit too long for anybody that's, you know, interested in the topic for this video, which is the crisis of manhood and masculinity. Last week, I attended a convention, a conference, a seminar on this topic, and it's a topic that I've become increasingly aware of over the last few years as I began to look at my own life and a lot of the challenges that I've had throughout my life and looking at the root cause of these. And this issue has manifested in almost every area of life when it comes to success and business and effectiveness, when it comes to relationships and marriage and family, when it comes to even health and wellness, as well as spirituality. This is such an important topic and something that is now beginning to emerge increasingly on as a topic of discussion amongst certain groups of population, groups of the population, among certain groups of people that are beginning to address this and realize that we are in a crisis of manhood and masculinity. So much of the current culture is actually anti-manhood, anti-masculinity. So much of what's happening in our culture is actually diminishing and attempting to paint masculinity in general in a very negative light. In fact, the American Psychological Association recently, and again, this is just a new cultural reality, which is not for the benefit of human beings. I'll get to this inshallah in a few minutes, where this is coming from, right? But there's this push, this movement to move humanity away from masculinity, to move men away from being masculine, from being men. In fact, there's this entire movement now to dissolve gender polarity and just create some sort of new androgynous, bizarre, strange reality in which there is no real male and female, masculine and feminine. Everybody's just sort of the same. This is completely insane. Allah Almighty has established in creation, if somebody believes, and again, this is my opinion. Anybody that comes across this video, you're welcome to have your thoughts, your opinions. This is my opinion. And I think my audience, the people that tend to tune into what I do, hopefully will understand and resonate. And again, this is a faith-based perspective and paradigm. It comes from faith and belief in the Creator. And Allah Almighty, the Creator God, has mentioned throughout the Quran again and again, polarity, male and female, without ambiguity, without complexity, without, you know, any confusion about that. Allah says He created the day and the night, the sun and the moon, male and female. Right? So Allah Almighty clearly defines polarity, difference between male and female, between masculine and feminine. And this is part of balance. Everything in creation, everything in the universe must exist in balance. And male or masculine requires feminine, the male requires the female, and vice versa. It is the driving force of life itself to become, let's say, to experience wholeness or connection or oneness or unity or love, where these two manifestations of Allah's attributes, the masculine and the feminine, seek to complete each other to become whole through or with one another. Allah Azza wa Jalla, I've spoken about this in a couple of other places, his qualities, his attributes manifest in creation as either Jalal or Jamal, as powerful and mighty or as beautiful. And men are dressed with the Jalali attribute of Allah, which the world is now trying to eradicate and take men away from, to the detriment and the destruction of humanity. And again, we'll get to that in a minute. Right, so men are dressed with the Jalal attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He has willed, as it is meant to be. Women, the feminine, are dressed with the Jamal, the beauty, the softness, right, the gentleness. And these are both necessary, and every human being has both of these attributes within them. Although balance for every human being is going to be different, for men, balance for them will be more masculine. There will be a greater component of the masculine to actually create balance in the man, more feminine in the woman. So the modern world is actually trying to turn reality and creation inside out and upside down. It's actually trying to make women more masculine and men more feminine, to the detriment and to the destruction of the human race. Each creation of Allah, the man and the woman, the male and the female, have been endowed with unique gifts, with their own beauty. And they are necessary for the perpetuation of life and of balance, and even the preservation of human culture. So by design, by divine design, the masculine inherits these attributes from Allah that drive it towards being a protector, being a provider, acting with nobility and with excellence, acting with valor and honor and courage, and to do what's right. And this is what Satan, what Shaitan, cannot stand. We can look at, for example, the example of one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, Sayyidina Umar, the great Umar, who the Prophet ﷺ said, if there was a prophet to come after him, it would be Umar, the second of his rightly guided khalifas. He was so powerful as a man that the Prophet ﷺ said, when Umar walks down the street and Satan sees him, Shaitan sees him, Shaitan will go a different way to avoid Umar. That was the level of his manhood, his state as a rajul, as a man of Allah. And there's this state, this maqam of rijalullah, the men of Allah. It's a spiritual state, and actually some women have attained to that as well, but that's an entirely different discussion that transcends gender. That's a spiritual rank and station where one now inherits the capacity and the ability to act as a deputy of Allah. Right. When Allah created, He created Adam alayhi salam and established Adam as His deputy, right? And so that is the divine creation, structure, order of reality. Everything is based on balance. And so now the modern world is doing its best to destroy what has existed and worked for thousands of years, tens of thousands of years. And it's not just even limited to the human species. All of creation is male and female, and they're distinctly different. A male lion is completely different than a female lion. It's absurd that we even have to have this discussion. A male gorilla is completely different than a female gorilla, and so on, right? Throughout the animal kingdom, and you even have male and female amongst trees and plants, and they serve different functions. They have different purposes, and each plays its role. It is a satanic quality to refuse to play one's role because of a disease like a virus that infects the mind. That is a satanic quality. When Allah created, He established Adam alayhi salam as His Khalifa and then told the rest of creation, that is my representative. Your job is not to question, not to argue, not to resist, but to surrender, bow down. And the creation bowed, except for Iblis and those who followed him. They refused the divine order, the divine structure, the divine hierarchy that Allah created. He refused, and he became accursed. That was his rebellion, refusing divine order, divine structure, divinely established hierarchy. He refused to play his role. He wanted what Adam alayhi salam was given, and only a madman would actually seek that responsibility. My sheikh used to say only a crazy person would want to be a sheikh. If you really understood what a sheikh is, if you really understood the responsibility that leadership requires, leadership is not power over others. Leadership is power for others. Leadership is service. It's not to be served. Who would want to take additional burden and responsibility, hardship and difficulty on their shoulders for the sake of other people? Those people have misunderstood leadership. Those are the corrupt. And the Prophet ﷺ said, anybody who seeks to become a leader, do not let that one to become the leader, because their intention is corrupt, their intention is wrong, and they are seeking power over others. They are seeking benefit and gain. That is not real leadership. That is not authentic deputyship. A true leader is a servant to his people. A true head of household is a servant to his family. And it doesn't mean that they bow their head and are weak and disempowered in their family and getting walked over. Not at all. They may have to be firm and strong and say no, but they're doing everything for the sake of those whom they are responsible for. And so what the modern world is trying to do is remove a man's ability to be a man. You see this throughout media, culture, programming, even scientific literature at this point. So as I was saying earlier, the American Psychological Association has recently stated that traditional masculinity is a mental disorder, if you can believe such insanity. They have lost all credibility at this point. And this attempt to paint masculinity as toxic is a strategy to destroy the human race. Because the one, the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the attribute of Allah that will stand up against Satan and his ilk and satanic influences is the Jalal. It's the masculine. That is the role of the man in a household. That is the role of a man in a family. That is the role of a man in a community, to be the guard at the front, right? To be at the vanguard to protect his people, his community, his family, his tribe from evil and from evil influences. That is the true nature of a man, to be a warrior and to protect, to sacrifice himself for the sake of the others. That has always been the role of men throughout history. And this idea that, you know, subhanAllah, it's almost as if history is being rewritten at this point in human culture or human society in the modern world to negate reality for the last tens of thousands of years, that men have sacrificed themselves so that others may survive, so that their women may survive, so that their children may survive. Men have done this, and it was considered honorable and noble, valorous. And now to paint that quality as somehow toxic or something that we have progressed beyond, reality doesn't change. Nature doesn't change, no matter how much modern society and culture wants to artificially attempt to make it do so. Reality will not change. And so I attended this conference about manhood and masculinity, and I heard, you know, quite a wide range of different opinions and perspectives from just people's personal experiences to scientific data. And it was, again, very eye-opening because it was an opportunity to see what's happening at the edge of what is essentially now almost a cultural war. And so many people are realizing that it's time, that it's necessary for a return to tradition, a return to faith-based lives, and a return to divine order as Allah Almighty has created. And this is across religions and traditions. So you'll see amongst this movement towards the inversion of reality and nature, natural order and traditional hierarchy, a movement towards disbelief. You can see it clearly. And it's moving towards disbelief and unbelief. And the traditional, of course, is always moving back towards traditional faith. When men no longer function as men, everything collapses, because the masculine is there to establish order. It's there to establish structure. It's there to protect. When you remove that, then everything collapses. Everything devolves into chaos. A healthy society, a healthy family, a healthy community requires the masculine and the feminine, each playing their roles to the best of their abilities, being what they were created to be. The modern world is attempting to artificially manipulate culture to prevent human beings from being what they were meant to be, and it is leading to misery and to death and to destruction. You can never be happy by being or trying to be something you're not, or by being conditioned to aspire to be something that you are not. And so we have this crisis where men no longer know how to be men, or are afraid to be men, afraid to be what they were created to be. As a result, everything is collapsing, most notably, most significantly, the family unit. This is on complete destruction at this point, the family unit. Not just through divorce, and not just through, you know, so many of the consequences of this issue. You know, the Prophet ﷺ said that the man, the father, the man, the husband, is essentially the sheikh of his family, meaning the protector of his family, the leader, the guide, the shepherd. And a flock without a shepherd is easy prey. And that really is the goal of shaitan, to rob men of their natural ability to serve as protectors and providers, as men, to be masculine, because at that point, everything else is easy prey. Everything else is easily consumed. When you destroy the marriage, the relationship between husband and wife, when that is destroyed, everything else collapses. The children are consumed by the society. And when you add to it all of the economic factors and circumstances, public education, like you put all these factors together, it is all destroying the most sacred thing which faith is meant to protect. That is the family unit. And when the family unit collapses, when structure and tradition are taken away to protect and sustain the family unit, all of society fails. And what does Satan want more than anything? This is what he wants: chaos, separation, destruction, conflict, competition. The modern paradigm is based in competition. It's not about harmony. It's about competition between male and female, as if they're both supposed to be somehow competing in the masculine domain. How can you have harmony if the relationship or the paradigm is already based in competition? You cannot. It will inevitably lead to continual conflict. And at the end of the day, nobody is happy, because nobody's living as they were created to live. And people end up realizing this only when it's too late, usually in their 30s or 40s, and they look back, if they're willing to admit, if they even know that there's an alternative to the chaotic and insane culture that we are being sort of immersed in at this point in this day and age. At that point, it's usually too late. What can you do? You can't go back and undo the last 20 years and the way you've been living, right? So we lose. And then the next generation is already lost at that point. There is a crisis of manhood and masculinity, and it's something that men specifically need to wake up to. We're not taught how to be men any longer. In fact, so much of the population is raised by single mothers nowadays, for the most part, with limited exposure and contact to men and to their fathers. And so they never really learn how to become men. They never really learn, and manhood must be developed, it must be acquired. It's not something that happens automatically, naturally. Males will grow, they will age, but that doesn't make a man. You can have a boy in a 40-year-old's male's body, or even beyond. That doesn't become a man. Manhood is a rank, it's a station. There must be a transition into manhood, and only men can make men. It's no other way. And every traditional society has had a rite of passage for boys to become men. That, for the most part, no longer exists. It's a little different for women. Women, through their biology and nature, naturally develop into women. It's a completely different reality in that sense. There's a point at puberty where a woman's body changes and she becomes a woman, and so on. But for men, they must be made into men. There are things that a man must learn, and really it comes to dealing with the world and learning how to engage the world in a way that is effective, that is noble, that is healthy, that is balanced, and that is excellent. And this is not something that happens naturally. So we have nowadays a crisis of manhood, and most males are not becoming men. And it's the most difficult thing to do. It's the most difficult thing to become. It's the most difficult thing to learn. It's also the most necessary, especially, right, for the men within our community, within the world, within our community as Muslims even. We've got to come back to realizing the importance of this topic. We have to remember that our enemy is not one another, it's not men and women, but our enemy is Satan. And he rules and he conquers through the ancient strategy of divide and conquer. And so he's created a world now where the unconscious bias and paradigm is based in competition and conflict rather than in harmony and in health, which leads to happiness. As believers, as people of faith, we have to become wise and sometimes stand against our own selves and our own egoic impulses for the truth and for what's real, and to simply live in ways that are healthy and harmonious. We have to remember we are not here on this world forever. This is not our home. We are passing through. And all these things that people are fighting for will mean nothing in the end. The only thing that will mean anything in the end is the goodness with which we lived, the happiness and the harmony with which we lived with others, the love that we cultivated and awakened and preserved. And again, the secret to love, real love and harmony, is humility. It cannot be achieved through arrogance and through ego and through pride, through self-assertion. This is the movement of the modern world. But again, I wanted to sort of address this while it was fresh in my mind and share this with you guys, and to at least begin to open this conversation. It's something I've been thinking about a lot over the last few years, out of necessity, out of really just personal trauma and failure, right? And I've been trying to figure out what is going on. Like, I realized that so much of the challenges and hardships in our lives are not just personal, but they're systemic. And I've also come to realize that at the root of our success and failure is our culture. The modern culture is not designed for the success of human beings, not real success. It's actually moving towards the destruction of human health and happiness. And so it's something we have to start talking about with intelligence, and we have to stand for truth. It's our duty, it's our responsibility to fight for goodness, to fight with excellence, to fight with light, right? And to fight with truth. That really is our weapon, truth, and to speak for it and stand for it, inshallah. May Allah Almighty keep us on the straight path, the path of balance and the path of excellence, the path of nobility, and guide us to the fulfillment of the purpose with which He created us, and that which leads to our happiness, to our health, and to our success, both in this life and in the next. Really, the happiness, it was a poet, and I don't remember exactly who the poet was, Sufi poet, Muslim poet, that said that the happiness of a human being is their home, it's their family. That's the closest that we will experience heaven on earth. It's in the love when you come home and your spouse is there, or in your home, you're experiencing love between, and happiness, really harmony between you and your spouse and your children. There is respect, there is mercy, there is compassion, there is love. That is the closest that a human being will come to the experience of heaven on earth. And that is what Satan wants to rob humanity of now, to destroy the family unit. We have to stand, we have to fight. We have to stand for the truth. He wants to destroy that and to maximize human suffering. This is the way to do it. I'll end with this last story, which I remember hearing when I was early days studying Islam and religion over 20 years ago, that there was a majlis, a gathering of devils, of shayateen, out on the ocean, out on the water, that this is where they would hold their gatherings, and they were sitting, and the head shaitan, the head devil, was asking the other devils what they did throughout the day, the last 24 hours, what they were able to inspire or manipulate human beings to do. And one devil said, I caused somebody to steal. I caused another one said, I inspired this one to lie. Another one said, you know, inspired this one to kill someone. And then there was a small little shaitan, right? They come in different physical states and builds as well. There was one small Satan, one small shaitan at the back, and he said, I caused a fight between a man and his wife, between a man and a woman, between a husband and his wife. I caused them to fight and to separate. And then the head Satan said, you are the best one. And he said, come and sit next to me. You did the best job out of everybody. You did the greatest work. This is what Satan wants to do, to destroy the relationship between men and women, between husband and wife, because in doing so, he destroys the family, he destroys the children, and really destroys the religion. The Prophet ﷺ said, marriage is half the religion. As believers, we must be vigilant and on guard. Remember that we are passing through this life, and all we want to do is to reach the Akhirah, to stand in Allah Almighty's presence, with Him pleased with us. When the Prophet ﷺ looks towards us, that he smiles, that he's happy. And what will be pleasing to Allah, what will be pleasing to the Prophet ﷺ, is humility, nobility, excellence, restraint of the ego, and the evolution of the self. May Allah Almighty keep us on the straight path. Be well and be blessed, brothers and sisters. Fi aman Allah, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.